In the early fall of 9 AD, the Roman commander Publius Quinctilius Varus takes over 15,000 Roman legionaries into what is now northwest Germany to put down a revolt among the German tribes there. With him is a 25-year-old German mercenary, Prince Arminius of the Cherusci tribe. Arminius is with Varus for the purpose of getting the Cherusci to cooperate with the Romans to put down the uprising. Little does Varus know that this princely soldier of fortune is about to deliver the Roman army its greatest defeat. It can be said that the Romans were off to put down the uprising in Germania because of the efforts of Arminius. Arminius was a shrewd man, and, being a Cheruscan prince, hoped to someday be king of his tribe. He knew the German tribes did not want to be made Roman subjects, and, as the Roman historian Cassius Dio says,
"They were in no mood to submit, for their leaders longed for their former ascendancy, and the masses preferred their accustomed condition to foreign domination."
Varus, the former governor of Syria, had been sent to Germania by Caesar Augustus to turn the territory into a proper Roman province, and Arminius would stand for no such thing. Thus, he formulated a plan to beat the Romans back and keep them out of Germania forever. According to the Roman historian Velleius Paterculus, Varus had been
brought to such a degree of negligence that he came to look upon himself as a city praetor administering justice in the forum, and not general in command of an army in the heart of Germania.
Arminius planned to capitalize on Varus' negligence of the true situation in Germany, and divulged his plan to attack the Romans to his fellow tribesmen, finally selecting a day for the attack. However, Varus wasn't completely ignorant of Arminius' plan. Paterculus tells us that the German Segestes told Varus about the plot to destroy the army, but that
fate now dominated the plans of Varus, and had blindfolded the eyes of his mind. Indeed, it is usually the case that heaven perverts the judgment of the man whose fortune it means to reverse, and brings it to pass, and this is the most wretched part of it, that that which happens by chance seems to be deserved, and accident passes over into culpability. And so Quinctilius refused to believe the story, and insisted upon judging the apparent friendship of the Germans toward him by the standard of his merit. And, after this first warning, there was no time for a second.
After entering Germania, Varus began to split up his legions, placing detachments of men in the villages the army passed through to protect the road. Soon, Arminius and his men asked Varus if they could break away from the army and gather their forces and rendezvous with Varus later. Varus said yes, and Arminius mustered his forces. The legionaries stationed in the German villages were promptly murdered by the villagers, and Arminius's men entered the deep German forests. To quote Cassius Dio,
"And there, at that very moment of revealing themselves as enemies instead of subjects, they wrought great and dire havoc."
The Romans themselves didn't have an easy time of it before they were attacked. According to Cassius Dio,
"They had with them many wagons and many beasts of burden, as in a time of peace. Moreover, not a few women and children and a large retinue of servants were following them. One more reason for their advancing in scattered groups. Meanwhile, a violent rain and wind came up that separated them still further, while the ground that had become slippery around the roots and logs made walking very treacherous, and the tops of trees kept breaking off and falling down, causing much confusion."
Arminius and the Cherusci tribesmen and their allies surrounded Varus and his army in the forest. The Romans, being scattered among the baggage trains and unarmed, were not able to form a cohesive fighting force, and thus not able to easily defend themselves. The Germans then began to perform hit-and-run attacks on the Roman ranks over a period of 4 days, helped by heavy rains that hampered the Roman escape and prevented them from taking up a defensive position. As Cassius Dio tells us,
"A heavy downpour and violent wind assailed them, preventing them from going forward and even from standing securely, and moreover depriving them from the use of their weapons, for they could not handle their bows or their javelins with any success, nor for that matter their shields, which were thoroughly soaked. Their opponents, on the other hand, being for the most part lightly equipped and able to approach and retire freely, suffered less from the storm. Furthermore, the enemy's forces had greatly increased, as many of those who had at first wavered joined them, largely in the hope of plunder, and thus they could more easily encircle and strike down the Romans, whose ranks were now thinned, many having perished in the earlier fighting."
What happened to Varus's army over those 4 days can only be described as ironic. Velleius Paterculus says it best.
Hemmed in by forests and marshes and ambuscades, it was exterminated almost to a man by the very enemy whom it had always slaughtered like cattle.
While his men were being decimated by Arminius's Germanic warriors, Varus, fearing capture and death at the hands of the Germans, took his own life by falling on his sword. Many of the officers followed suit and took their own lives as well, and when it was learned that Varus was dead, many of the remaining legionaries gave in to their attackers, either surrendering or allowing themselves to be killed. When the battle had ended, three entire legions, the 17th, the 18th, and the 19th, and several cohorts were completely destroyed and their aquilae captured. One of Varus's officers' deaths is notable not because of heroism, but because of cowardice, even in the face of an enemy so strong as the Cheruscans and their allies. Valinumonius, Varus's lieutenant, who was considered by Paterculus to be an honorable man,
set a fearful example in that he left the infantry unprotected by the cavalry and in flight tried to reach the Rhine with his squadrons of horse. But fortune avenged his act, for he did not survive those whom he had abandoned, but died in the act of deserting them.
In the aftermath of the battle, Varus's partially burned and mutilated corpse was decapitated by the Germans, who sent the head to King Maroboduus of the Marcomanni in Bohemia, one of the strongest tribes in the area, hoping Maroboduus would join the fight for German freedom. However, rather than keep the head as a trophy, Maroboduus sent the head to Caesar Augustus, who then gave it to Varus's family. The head was buried in Varus's family tomb. The news of the Varian disaster spread back to Rome quickly. Upon hearing of Varus' defeat and the loss of the 17th, 18th, and 19th legions, Suetonius tells us that Caesar Augustus did not cut his beard or hair, and mourned, calling out, "Varus, give me back my legions!" Augustus continually mourned this defeat until the end of his principate. 6 years after Varus's defeat and the destruction of the legions, the Romans came back to Germania to defeat Arminius, who was still at large, and bring free Germania under Roman control. At the head of this army was Germanicus Julius Caesar, Emperor Tiberius's nephew. In his campaign in Germania, Germanicus soon came upon the remains of Varus's defeated legions. The historian Tacitus describes it thus.
In the center of the field were the whitening bones of men, as they had fled or stood their ground, strewn everywhere or piled in heaps. Near lay fragments of weapons and limbs of horses, and also human heads prominently nailed to trunks of trees. In adjacent groves were barbarous altars on which they immolated tribunes and first-rank centurions. Some survivors of the disaster who had escaped from the battle or from captivity described how this was the spot where the officers fell, how yonder the eagles were captured, where Varus was pierced by his first wound, where too by the stroke of his own ill-starred hand he found himself death. They pointed out too the raised ground from which Arminius had harangued his army, number of gibbets for the captives, the pits for the living, and how, in his exultation, he insulted the standards and eagles.
After finding the site, Germanicus and his men buried the remains of Varus's army and brought closure to the greatest Roman defeat since the defeat of Crassus by the Parthians. However, the Battle of Teutoburg Forest, as saddening and damaging as it was to Rome, profoundly changed the course of world history forever. By preventing Roman expansion, Arminius and the Cheruscans allowed the Germanic peoples to later influence Europe and lay the foundations of the modern world.